Which were many Savior of washed the way, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart, I shall go there to dwell in that city I know. Since Jesus came into my heart, and I'm happy, so happy as onward I go. Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Amen. Sister Gordon.
Lord, thank you for this day that you give us, Lord. Thank you for the ones that are here today, Lord. Thank you for the ones that aren't here, Lord. Lord, we just ask you to put those in your presence today, Lord. Lord, we love you. We give God the glory for us to be here today. In Christ Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. In our bulletins, you will see that we will be having our second VBS meeting next Sunday on the 21st. And VBS getting closer and closer. And we still have some decisions to make on a lot of things. So we need people's presence and their help in coming to the meeting and things, so we know what's going on and who and what is where and all these things. And the scheme, the theme of our VBS is Scuba Dive into Friendship with God. So I hope and pray that if you want to take a part in our VBS, that you'll come. The church will be having a quarterly business meeting during the Wednesday evening service on April the 24th. So all members are welcome to come and to attend these things. And then 2 weeks from today, the church will be having a potluck lunch following the Sunday worship service. And that will be on Sunday, April the 28th. And we'll have a few more details to come next week about that. So basically, it's bring something and we'll eat it. I mean, you know, it can't be any more explaining or than that, dealing with a potluck. You know, potluck is whatever's in the pot and we'll be lucky to get it. So just bring something and we'll eat it. Of course, then on the back, there's always something that's worthy of your reading, and I hope that you'll do those things on our bulletin as well. Jimmy?
If I didn't say it, we'll go. I apologize for Cigar Hardly Highway Hymn, second edition, and continue in that book. We'll turn to page number 9. And we'll sing all three verses. Page number 9.
I must needs go home by the way of the cross. There's no other way but this. I shall ne'er reach sight of the gates of life if the way of the cross I miss. The way of the cross.
Lead
on
the way of the cross. Lead on.
Lead on. It is sweet to know as I onward go the way of the cross. Lead on. I must needs go on in the blood sprinkle way. The path that the Savior trod. If I ever climb to the heights sublime where the soul is at home with God, the way of the cross leads on.
The way of the cross leads on.
Leads on. It is sweet to know as I onward go the way of the cross leads home. Then I bid farewell to the way of the world, to walk in it nevermore. For my Lord says, come, and I seek my home where he waits at the open door. The way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross
leads home.
Leads home. It is sweet to know as I onward go.
Page number 17. Page number 17, we'll see you all, sing all three. Stand on the last before we take our morning offering this morning. Page 17. I have
found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Oh, all my griefs have taken,
and all my sorrows borne. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's a lily of the valley, that bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will, a wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you for who you are and what you do. And Father, I ask for your presence this morning. There's not many here, but we just ask you to fill our hearts this morning with your word. Open our minds and to your word, and Father, we will understand what is meant is being said. Father, just continue to bless us and guide us. Continue to keep us strong in your faith in this world that we live in. Father, take this offering that's been given this morning to do it to the will of your house. Among so many that are still sick, ailing, but there are also so many, Lord Father, that need to be here to hear your word, Lord Father, to open their hearts and just intervene in their souls, Lord Father, that they need to be in their place. Father, again, I just love you for everything that you do in my life, my family's life. Again, I just ask to keep our minds open this morning. We ask you now to forgive us all of our sins that we've done against you. In Christ's name I pray.
Your goodness is right.
do serve a faithful God.
Yeah.
You know, I guess the actual thing that it boils down to is, are we as faithful to Him as He is to us?
Right.
Before Easter we started, after Easter we finished, and then last night we were back in the same text as we went and heard Brother Warren Larson preach. But you know, in our text this morning, it records the Lord's last meeting with His disciples while He was here on earth. You know, our Lord is preparing to ascend back into heaven, to sit down at the right hand of God the Father. But before He leaves, He commands and He commissions His disciples to reach the world with His message.
Yeah.
The message of the good news of the gospel.
Yeah.
Amen.
He reminds them of what should be the central focus of their ministry.
Yeah.
And He reminds them that they are to keep the main thing the main thing. I do believe so much in the things that are of the church today is that we've lost the very focus of our ministry.
Yeah.
We'll do this and we do that and we do this and that and this and that, and we'll have programs about this and that and everything else. But you know, the real program is Jesus Christ and Him crucified,
right,
resurrected,
right,
ascended to heaven, and coming again.
Right.
Yeah. Now that ought to be our focus.
Yeah.
Now other things are good if we're doing good works, but our main focus should never change.
Right.
It should be Jesus.
Right.
Our Heavenly Father above gave us our central focus when He gave us Jesus. And if our heart and our mind and whatever we attempt, try to do, are doing, want to do, if the central focus of those things is not Jesus, then we don't need to be doing it. So let's go into our text this morning, Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. And let's all stand as we read His word this morning. It says, "The former treasures have I made, O Theophilus, and all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which He was taken up. After that, He, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom He had chosen, to whom also He showed Himself alive after His passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. And when they therefore come together, they ask of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all of Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Let us pray. Lord, we do come. Lord, we do come thanking you, Lord, for your very day that you bless us with the opportunity to come into thy house, Lord. And I thank you for those that have come this morning, Lord, availed themselves unto you to be here to worship together. And Lord, I pray now that as we, in these next few moments, as we come and we, in our worship service, Lord, that you would just guide what would be said and done in this place. And Lord, that you would be pleased when it is said and done. And Lord, we give praise and honor and glory to you for what you've done and what you're going to do this morning and what you're going to do in the days to come in and through this place. And Lord, we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Can be seated. You know, we take these things and we've seen these things in the last few weeks and things. And but you know, as we look according to God's holy word, it never really gets old. You know, it is truth. That in that truth, we find what we ought to be, and what we should be, and what we ought not and should not be, for sure. So we take these verses, and we find now that Jesus has been crucified, he has been resurrected, and he has spent these 40 days and things with the disciples. And he's been telling them, I believe that he's given them the short course of what he tried to be telling them in those 3.5 years in which they were together. And as he is telling them, he is giving them their marching orders. And by giving them their marching orders, he is giving the church today our marching orders as well. You know, we look and in this time, we find the Lord had to overcome even distractions. We saw that in verses 6 and 7. The disciples want to talk about future things. And Jesus is trying to conduct the world's first mission conference, and they want to turn it into a prophecy conference. Well, what's going to happen in the future? They want to know if the time has come for Jesus to establish his kingdom here on earth. And literally he tells them that the times and the seasons are none of their business. It's none of their concern. Their responsibility was to be faithful to him and his word while they waited on the king. And I give you this morning, nothing has changed. Our day is not to get caught up in the future of things. or in any other theological disputes that distract us from the main thing. We need to be careful that we do not allow Satan to distract us from our very purpose in being left in this world. Our duty is to be busy working for the Lord while we wait for Him to return. Verse 8 tells us what our duty is. Verse 8 said, "But we shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon us, and we shall be witnesses unto Him both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and unto the other parts of the earth." That's our job. That is what we are supposed to be doing. Now, I'm not saying that in the church of today that all the programs and all of this or that that is being prevalent and relevant in the church of today are bad, because I'm not saying that. But I'm saying if we don't do them with the main focus being Jesus Christ, then we're doing the wrong things. Jesus here is commanding His disciples. And I'm not just talking, we're not just dealing with these 11. Okay? 12 minus Judas gives us 11. And we're not just talking about these 11 of the days of Jesus, but we're talking about the 11 and all of the disciples that have come along and are prevalent today. You know, He commands His disciples living in all time periods to be His witnesses to the world of His gospel and witnesses of His saving grace. Many believers disagree about how salvation takes place, but it does not change the gospel. Verse 8 is very clear. Every believer is commissioned, commanded, and constructed to share the gospel with the lost world. We are His ambassadors in this place, according to 2 Corinthians 5, verse 20. So we need to know some of the qualities that are shared by all gospel witnesses. This text reminds us of exactly what we are to be doing as we move through this world. The passage teaches us about the main thing that the church is to be doing. So we need to examine this passage, and we need to look on it and try to grasp an understanding of it. And in the next few minutes, we have to understand the thing about keeping the main thing the main thing. Why do I say that this is the main thing? I say it because here's Jesus Christ, crucified, resurrected from the dead. He's about to ascend into heaven to take His rightful place, to right hand of God the Father. He could have talked about anything in the world. But his last words were a command and a commission to share the gospel. Yeah. If it was that important to him, shouldn't the church think it should be equally important to us today? The church needs to learn the lesson about keeping the main thing the main thing. Jesus could have said anything. He could have mentioned anything on this day, but he didn't. His last words, literally, because verse 9 says, "And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight." As he had spoken these things, refers to the last thing that he spoke. And that is the commission of all of his disciples. And that's you and me. The church.
Yeah.
But today, whether we're a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Church of Christ or a Methodist, Pentecostal, Assembly of God, and we could go on and on. Or maybe even just a non-denominational church, you know? Whatever. Whoever. The main thing is the gospel of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
The main thing is the good news. And it was that important to Jesus. No matter who or what we are, or what we think we are, it ought to be our main thing as well. And if it's not, then we need to change. We look, and we have to understand, first of all, that we must have the right message. We've got to have the right message. Jesus tells his men that they are to be witnesses unto me. Unto me, Jesus said. So, Jesus is to be the sole focus of their message. And if he is to be the sole focus of their message, then he needs to be the sole focus of our message. Today, it has not changed. We are to tell the world about him. We are not to walk or to talk about us, our lives, our beliefs, our denominations, our church, or our favorite preachers, or our programs. None of those things have saving power. None of those things will save an individual from hell.
Yeah.
His message does. In Romans, verse 1, and in chapter 1, and in verse 16, he says, "I am debtor." Well, that's 14. 16. 16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." The gospel of Christ is the power of God unto salvation. That's the first thing. That's the main thing. We are to tell the world about Jesus.
Amen.
We are not sent to tell anything else. We are to tell the message of His love, His death, His resurrection. We're to share the message of the gospel. We are to tell the world that Jesus will save anyone who will come to Him by faith. Anybody or anyone, man, woman, boy, girl, black, white, yellow, red, purple, pink, chartreuse green with red polka dots, if they will come and trust Jesus as Savior, He will save them. And that's whether they are a Baptist, a Presbyterian, a Church of Christ, a Methodist, a Pentecostal church, Assembly of God, and we could go on to anybody else.
Yes, Jesus. Thank you.
We are not sent to try and impress the world with our grasp of theology. Many people know the theories of theology, but they don't know Jesus. Many know all about the glories of heaven, but they're headed for hell. Like the blind man in John chapter 9, all I know is, once I was blind, but now I see. And Jesus is the reason. This is a passage, or this is the message rather, we are to share with the world. Our only mission is to point people to Jesus. He is the only hope the world has for salvation. As someone said, all we are is just one hungry beggar telling another hungry beggar where he can get a meal. And I tell you this morning, Jesus is the bread of life. He is that meal.
Yes.
He is the solution to spiritual hunger of this world today. You want to know what can fix our nation? It's called Jesus.
Yes.
You want to know what can fix our world today? Jesus. Yes. You want to know what can turn around and change people's hearts today? It's Jesus.
Yeah.
It's Him.
Yeah.
He is the solution to the spiritual hunger of the world today. And you know, we need to share with others what others had shared with us. We just didn't wake up one morning and determine, I'm going to get saved today, without somebody first telling us about Jesus, so that the Holy Spirit could then draw us to Him. Not only must we have the right message, we have to have the right methods. The word witness translates the Greek word of martyrs. It refers to those who bear witness to the truth. It came to be used of those who bore the ultimate witness to the truth, of those who laid down their lives for the truth. Thus we get our word martyr. This word. The issue is not myths and legends, but it is facts and truth. Jesus is calling His people to tell others the truth about Him.
Amen.
word witness was used in the Bible times like it's used today. It speaks of those who testify in a court of law. A witness in a trial is called upon to tell what they have seen and what they know to be true. So if we're saved today, and if we're to be witnesses of Jesus, then what we're supposed to be doing is telling what we have seen and what we know to be true of Him. God is calling His people to tell what they know and what they have seen to be true. Do you know anything about Jesus Christ? Has God done anything for you through His Son Jesus? And if you can answer yes to those questions, that is what you are to be telling the world about. Because what our message is, if He can do it for me, He can do it for you. Do you know this morning that God loves you? Then tell the world. Do you know that you are saved through Him and through Christ Jesus? Then tell the world. Do you know that God saves sinners? Tell the world. Do you know who you're supposed to be telling? The world. The world is anybody. We have some great examples in the Bible. We won't take time to go through them this morning. But here they are. We find Peter at Pentecost. They're in Acts 2, verses 14 through 41. We find Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts 8, verse 26 through 39. We find Paul before King Agrippa. They're in Acts 26, verses 1 through 31. We find the blind man before the Sanhedrin. They're in John 9, and verses 10 through 12, 15 through 17, 24 through 27, 30 through 33. These great witnesses just told what they knew. They told what they did. Not what they thought, not what could be, not what perhaps is. They taught, they witnessed what they knew. And that is all the Lord wants you to do as well. Just tell what you know. Right message. Right methods. We got to have the right mindset. You know, the witness in a court of law is to testify to the judge and jury. The witness to Jesus Christ is to testify to the whole world. It's a big task. It's so big that Jesus even recognized, so He breaks it down for us. We are to begin close and then move out. You know, we need to adopt the mindset of John Wesley, who said this. He said, "The world is my parish." Wesley knew that anywhere sinners could be found, there was a need for the gospel and the gospel witness. And folks, that's anywhere we go. Anywhere. Well, our mission field is anywhere lost people can be found. Folks, that could be church. Could be the grocery store, the gas station, our workplace. Could be a movie theater. Could be anywhere we happen to go. Wherever we go, wherever we set our feet is our mission field.
Yeah.
The people we come in contact wherever we go is who we ought to be telling about Jesus. Yeah. I've heard many people say, well, what if some of them are saved? Well, okay. If they're saved, they'll tell you. You'd hate to not give the message about our Lord Jesus Christ just because we think, oh, well, they're probably all saved over there. Because chances are they're not. And we could be the only witness that they give. Folks, most of us will never go to the uttermost part of the earth. And I understand it. But we can serve in our Jerusalem. In our Jerusalem. We can witness to our families, our friends, our co-workers, total strangers, to anyone we meet, anywhere we go. We are to always be on mission for Jesus, telling a lost and dying world that Jesus can save them. And if we get the opportunity to go out to our Judea, or perhaps even our Samaria, and even to the uttermost parts of the earth, we should make good use of those open doors. Everyone we meet is either a believer or they're in need of the gospel. There ain't but two types of people in the world today. Saved and lost. So let's tell them about our Savior. Let's share the glorious news that Jesus saves. And He will save all who will come unto Him by faith. Revelation 22 and in verse number 17. It says, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Let him take it freely. Let him come unto Jesus by faith. And what's really sad is that most believers will not talk to anyone who is outside their comfort zone. They'll visit friends, family, and acquaintances. But they won't go to someone who is lost. They're afraid to share the gospel outside of their own realm of safety. And as a result, most church members are not involved in any kind of evangelism. I mean, heck, we can't even get them to come to church.
Amen.
They have the mindset, my four and no more, when there's a whole world that must be reached with the gospel of grace.
Amen.
And it's our job to take it to them. It's not just my job as a pastor of Calvary Baptist Church. It's all of our job. It's all of us. If we really believe that people are going to hell without Jesus, and if we really believe that the gospel is for all men, then why aren't we doing more to get the gospel to them? If we really believe those things, and if it really has any effect on us at all, then why aren't we telling them? Why aren't we out there telling a lost world that Jesus saves? Could it be that maybe perhaps we really don't believe everything we claim to believe? Could it be that perhaps you're just saved and satisfied? Could it be that we have forgotten to keep the main thing, the main thing? We got to have the right message. We got to have the right method. We have to have the right mindset. We must have the right muscle. If our message is to have any power, if our methods are to be successful, if our mindset is ever to be what it ought to be, then we are going to need help from outside of ourselves. I can't do it on my own within my own self. And neither can you. Jesus tells us in this verse that our help comes from the Holy Ghost. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Our power comes after the Holy Ghost comes upon us. If we are lost today, we have no power. If we are playing church today and we really don't have the Holy Spirit within us, acting within us, indwelling within us, then we have no power. And I give you, there are many today in churches all over this morning that are sitting in a pew, that are playing, that are acting church, that have no power because they are lost. Because they have no Jesus within them. The people in the upper room were promised that the Spirit of God was coming, and that when He came, He would fill them with God's power. According to Luke 24, verse 49. And when that power came on that day of Pentecost, those terrified disciples who had been hiding from the Jews in fear became bold preachers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not anything else, no other message, but Jesus and Him crucified. See, that's the message of the cross.
Right.
What He accomplished for us.
Yeah.
And if He accomplished it for me, who like Paul and the chief of sinners, then boy, He could do it for another person. Or for anybody.
Amen.
When and they preached the gospel, we find that 3,000 souls were saved that day there on those, I believe, on the southern steps. According to Acts 2, verse 41. What made the difference? Well, I can give you, it wasn't their eloquence. Because none of them were religious people. And it certainly wasn't their oratory skills. All we got to do is look at Peter when we see that. It wasn't their delivery. What made the difference was the power of God on their lives. That's what made the difference. And this morning, that's what will make the difference in our lives. Yeah. Is the power of God in and through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Where did power come from? Well, it came from the very fact that they were saved and indwelled with the Holy Spirit. According to John 14, verse 16 through 18. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13. It came from the fact that they were prayed up and that they were clean before God. There in Acts chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, these all continue with one accord in prayer, in supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren up in that upper room. They stayed until the very power came upon them. They were prayed up, saved, prayed up. It came from the fact that they were united in love and in heart and in promise. Chapter 2 and verse 1 says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Their hearts were all set on the same thing. Their desire was all upon the same thing. It wasn't that we are better than you because of what we did. It's not because of what we do. And if you don't get on our bandwagon, then you're not enough. I give you this morning, they were all in one place, their hearts set on one thing. That's Jesus.
Yeah.
It was Jesus. You know, they were united in love, heart, and purpose. And you know, I think, and as I look and I realize, you know, that could be Calvary Baptist Church today. Could be. If those that could be, would be. You know, that same power is available to us today. If we are going to have the power of God on our witness, our words, our works, then we are going to have to get our lives in the kind of shape that the Lord can bless and use. We are going to have to get like the early church. We look in Acts chapter 2 and in verses 42 through 47. It says that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in the breaking of bread and in prayer. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common. Sold their possessions and good part of them to all men, as every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved.
Man.
They had the same heart, folks. They had the same wants. They were all in the same accord. The same beliefs. When we do these things, we will see the Lord pour out His power on our witness to the world. And until we do, we will just be spinning our wheels and accomplishing nothing for His glory. We desperately need God's power on our lives and on our church today. It's not only our church. It's all church. It's church in general. We will never enjoy His unction and His power until our hearts are right with one another and with Him. You know, if we have a problem with a brother or sister, then we've not dealt with the issue biblically, it's a hindrance to the power of God being manifested in our life. If we have some secret sin buried in our lives, it's a hindrance to the power of God being manifested within us. We need to stop looking at others and deal with our own hearts. And when we do, and when we get where we could, where He could have us to be, we can and we will enjoy the power on our witness. Folks, we're not perfect. But we need to be where God wants us to be. How important is being a witness to you? What are you willing to change in your life so that you can be more effective as a witness? What are you willing to deal with so that the power of God may rest upon you? What price are you willing to pay today for the touch of God on your life? How long has it been since you told someone else about Jesus? Let me just remind you that every one of us will give an account of our witness to Jesus someday. The hour is late. And I give you the time to tell the world is now. It's now. I believe that, church, we've been distracted from our mission. I think we all share some responsibility in that. Me the most. This is the hour to recapture our mission unto God. This is the moment when the main thing needs to become the main thing once again.
Yeah.
It's time to deal with our personal issues, and it's time to deal with our sins so that the power of God might rest upon us and that God might be pleased. Save souls in this place and in and through this place once again.
Right.
I give you this warning. It's time to obey His voice. If He thought that it was needful enough to make it His last words before He ascended, to make it the last thing that He tells the disciples, if He makes it the last thought that He put in their heart that day, don't you think it's important enough that it ought to be our thought today? Let's all stand. Lord, we do come this morning. Lord, we do stand before You today, Lord, a church that just needs Your touch. Lord, we stand before You today as a people who need Your touch today. Lord, we come before You realizing that we need to put the main thing back as the main thing. And realize that we have the power of the Holy Spirit residing within us. And through that realization, we need to realize that that commission, that mission that He gave the disciples that day, is the same commission and the mission that He's giving us today. It was relevant then, it's relevant now, and it'll be relevant tomorrow. Lord, I pray that as Your people, that You will not only impress upon us, but Lord, that You may give us that fresh taste of Holy Ghost power today. Lord, I pray that You'd use this invitation
Lord, as only you can. Help us to seek out you today.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His daily presence will.
It's a need today. You know, the one thing we've failed to realize. We all get caught up in numbers. Oh, we had this many in our church. We had this many get saved. We had this many baptisms. We've had this many this, that, and the other. And even in and through this, the facts of what we read here in the second chapter of Acts, do you realize that the 3,000 got saved because somebody brought the message to them? The Holy Spirit fell that day. But they got saved because someone brought the message of Jesus to them. And they believed. You know, somewhere in this equation, each of us find ourselves in one place or another. Are we the one in need of the message? Are we the one that ought to be taking the message? Only each heart knows that. But the Lord can supply. Amen. We're gonna start a new study this evening. Some of the minor prophets. So we're gonna be there. We're gonna take four of them, and as they lead into another, we're gonna go that direction, I think. So I hope you'll be back with us. We do have VBS meeting on the 21st at 5 o'clock. business meeting on the 24th and potluck lunch on the 28th. We'd love to have you, but we can't do that until you come and be with us. So let's pray and we'll be dismissed this morning. Lord, we do come thanking you, Lord, for your many blessings. Lord, we thank you for the opportunities that you give us. Lord, I thank you for the message, Lord, that you in your word that we found this morning. I believe, Lord, it is a pertinent message for today. It's pertinent for the church. It's pertinent for the believer. It's pertinent for my heart. Lord, I pray that you'd use what we've heard today, Lord. And Lord, that as we leave this place, that we would apply what we've heard. And Lord, by doing so, we would bring honor and glory to your holy name. Lord, we love you. We thank you. For it's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.